Justin's been great. The best part of the team probably for us as a staff was just getting our families here. We spent 3.5 months living in what we call the frat house. And six guys with no wives and no kids trying to recruit 10 guys at once. And then you end up in that pocket of time where you get the 10 on campus and you get to a full 13. And I think we realized what a good job we did. It's an incredibly difficult situation with the portal and everything else. And Dusty leaving, he got this legacy to kind of live up to. And we love our guys, and we think we're in a great spot.
What are some of the unique and the biggest challenges that will come with almost an entirely new team? You know, Trey is still there and a couple other guys, but just an entirely new team getting to know each other and play at this level.
Yeah, I think the best way to just kind of look at that and address it is just the fact that our league in general, the American, was the most plucked league in all the country. So I have friends in this business and they're all dealing with the same thing. Some guys lost 8, some guys lost 6, we lost 10. But at the end of the day, this is the new normal. So I would say if I did this 5 years ago and we lost 10, it would have been a really rough situation. But just because of the size of the portal, normal landscape, this is what people are doing now. You try not to judge your situation, you just try to have a growth mindset and do the best you can with where you're at, and I think we did that.
What are you the most excited about with this team without even seeing a game yet? What do you know this team will exhibit?
I think we've done a really good job with having these guys fall in love with each other. And we spent a ton of our time on team building, on building a culture. And the way they feel about each other, I think, reflects on the way they play. And we're assisting over 60% of our baskets in practice, the way we share. I think the camaraderie, all of that, just the way it's run through from off the floor to on the floor is probably the thing we're most proud of.
The American is one of the stronger basketball conferences, but looking at building the non-con schedule, what was that process like building that schedule in order to bring FAU back to a third consecutive March bid?
Yeah, I think that there's a few teams in our league that did a really good job of trying to get that large bid, and I think we were one of them. And when you're stuck in our situation, kind of in between, you've got to do some things that are unique. Playing a Thanksgiving tournament with 4 or 5 high majors in it is pretty normal. But we're going on the road at UCF and Michigan State so we can get a chance at a quad one wins. And the way the math works now, if you're really good at the math when it comes to getting into the tournament, if you lose, it almost means nothing to you. And if you win, you get this huge bump with the quad one win, a chance to be a large team. So I would say 10 years ago, you would never play the schedule we're about to play because your goal was to get to 20 wins and then do well in your league and then maybe get in a tournament by different math. But with this math, you need 5 or 6 quad one opportunities just to get a chance to be in a large team. So we took swings by doing that. We're going to play 5 or 6 for sure, and hopefully we'll end up on the right side of that bubble.
Coach, is there been anyone on this roster or multiple guys that you would say, maybe like pleasantly surprised by how they've shown up in the first couple weeks, months?
I don't know that anybody's pleasantly surprised. I think you recruit what you get. I would say I'm pretty pleased with the 3 guys that stayed. And Trey and Dev and Kel, I'm incredibly thankful for them. The reality is everybody else chose to go and they chose to stay. And I would say their summer, they've taken as big a leap as anybody on our team. And but what Trey's doing at the wing spot, what Dev's doing at some point guard and reading ball screens, I don't think we saw that coming. And both of them have taken a huge leap.
Coach, some footers in college basketball just don't grow on trees. How did you find Montas and Matas, and what was the pitch to recruit them to play college basketball in the U.S.?
Well, the short answer is Ty Abernathy. I think the best thing we did was keep him on our staff. He's coached in the Final Four with FAU. He's been an SEC assistant. He recruited Montas before I got here with Dusty's staff, and then he was also the lead recruiter to Montas. But half our team is international. We know you can find guards anywhere, especially in the States. But we went overseas to find guys. Our goal was to have 5 or 6 between 6'5 and 7'1, and all with a plus wingspan. And we were able to do that. So whether it was a Baylor or a Gonzaga, Africa or Europe, we've always kind of gone outside the States to find our picks. And it's sort of the same reason you asked the question. It's just really hard to find 7-footers that can play.
Yeah, and then just to follow up on that, can you kind of speak to their character as a young man, and then also on the basketball court, how beneficial is it for the offense that you want to run to have 2 7-footers on the team?
Yeah, I would say we have 3 with Baba, and I would say his time at Real Madrid, and then Matas and Matas' time at Zalgiris. That's 2 of the best EuroLeague teams in the world. They've been coached at the highest level by some of the best coaches in the world. All those coaches you see in the Olympics that give USA fits, those are guys that coached at places like Real Madrid out here. So from the time they're 15, 16, they leave their home, and they've been coached by some of the best coaches in the world. So their IQ is an absolute gift. And you can see the way basketball is going to five out with Jokic and Bam Adebayo. The fact that they can do that European ball screen stuff now before they can get here is great for our offense.
How do you help them kind of adapt culturally off the court? It's not just them, but all the international players as well, and make them feel comfortable here.
I think half our locker room is international. So in some sense, they're all walking into the same situation. There's an academic adjustment, but I feel like our academic department's done a great job. For some of them, there's a language adjustment. This is the first time they've ever been coached in English. But for the most part, basketball is a little bit like music. It's a universal language. The only place they feel safest is in our gym. And then I would say that we went out of our way to hire two or three NBA guys on our staff, and then a couple of younger guys, former players, that can really relate to young players. So between the staff and half our team being international, I think the camaraderie there has been pretty simple.
Has anyone stood out in particular as a vocal leader of the team so far?
I think our staff would say Leland's the best vocal leader we got right now. Some guys are catching up pretty quickly. I think everybody's got moments. You're going to see Trey be loud at moments. You see Baba be loud at moments. But at the end of the day, if you're asking for one guy, I would say Leland's kind of separated himself there, and we're thankful for
that. What makes him separate from the rest of
the team? I think Nico and Leland in general both have played the point guard spot their whole life. And it's hard to find seven-footers, but it's incredibly hard to find guys that have brought the ball up the floor their whole life and actually understand what it means to run a team. So when we went in the portal, we went on purpose to find 2 point guards. And I think 13 of the last 15 or 14 of the last 15 national champions started 2 point guards. When I was at Gonzaga, we started 2 and lost North Carolina. When we won it all, we started 2, and Gonzaga also started 2 at Baylor. So 2 point guards is kind of a thing you need. And so just their ability to run the team makes it natural for them to talk.
One of those NBA assistants is Isaiah Austin, and you guys obviously spent a lot of time back at Baylor about 10 years ago. What's that relationship been like so far, your time?
Isaiah is one of the most meaningful people in my life, and top 5 player in my career when it comes to not just coaching basketball, but the way they've impacted me. And you do this thing, and I know it's kind of getting lost nowadays, but you do this thing to change people's lives. And people think that somehow changed because of the portal or because of NIL money. And in reality, that hasn't changed at all. If you let that or those circumstances change your heart, then you're missing the point. And when I have guys like Obim and Isaiah and Eric that have all coached here, it's because they allowed me to change their life, but in return, they changed mine. And I just think having that in the locker room every day is one of the reasons our guys get along so much. And when you're your first time head coach in a situation like this, there's not a day that those guys don't go in the locker room and have my back. And hiring Isaiah was one of the best decisions I could make.
Well said.
Season opener, mentioned people that you want to help out. Season opener in Zania, Ohio, Athletes in Action as an organization you have experience with. How did that game come about?
Yeah, one, I worked for them. But the key to that deal is John Wooden's family gave Athletes in Action the rights to use his name. So for a while, they've been trying to build a John Wooden Museum and Center. And the place for that just happens to be on their headquarters at Zania, Ohio. So they called me this summer and asked if I would play a neutral game to open the season. And I thought it was a great idea. Then it just comes down to opponent and fit and that whole deal. But Indiana State's in a very similar situation to us. They lost their head coach to St. Louis, and then they were in the portal. Dusty moved on to Michigan. We were in the portal, but both had unbelievable kind of name brand seasons last year. So it's a great opportunity for us to kick off in the right way. But AIA means a ton to me. They changed my life. I worked for them. That's how I became a pro coach overseas. They taught me what it meant to combine faith with basketball. And I can't think of a better way to start my time here than at one of their events.
So you already spoke a little bit about Trey's character on the court, but what about off the court? Is he as well as the other 3 returning players, Jake, Jackal, and Devin, are they kind of leading the team and showing them what the culture is like at FAU?
Yeah, I'd probably say that's one of the hardest balances you can go through, because you don't want to completely disregard what was done here prior, because they were pretty successful. I mean, if you made a list of schools that made the tournament the last 2 years, I bet you're not going past 25. And so out of 350 schools, this has been in a good spot. So we stole some of what is positive in them, what's positive in Todd as an assistant. But apart from that, I think we've worked really hard to build our own identity, not just because I believe in what Gonzaga and Baylor taught me, but because really good head coaches have learned this from Scott and Mark. They build things anew each year where you hold your convictions, but then you build it around the strength of the team as a whole. So if I was to build it around those four, I'd be missing 10 guys. And so we want to build our offense and defense around the larger structure of who we are. So they've impacted us in a positive way, but not in a way where they're going to trump the whole. And right now, the whole is the most important thing.
Well, I said I'm going to give a chance to talk to Trey after. Can you expand on just how he's handled this? You know, a lot of the faces around him have changed, but you mentioned that he's taken large steps forward. So I'm just wondering if you can assess sort of how he's been able to sort of concentrate on that when everything else around him is.
One thing I'm not nervous about is Trey speaking for himself. So I'm going to let him answer that question. But I hope he would say two things. One, we really know what we do when it comes to the basketball side, and that using him as a small ball five and a four and a wing has really grown his game. The player development piece, I think he's bought into us and we bought into him. The second thing I hope he says is that he would say, I love him. And I think that's just at the heart of what we do. And I think when you go through all this change, if you can find people who really believe in you and care about you, they calm you down. And I think in the last month specifically, Trey's really calmed down into his role. So those would be the two things I hope he says, but I'll let him answer the question himself.
What can you say about Bob Miller as a player and his role on the team?
Yeah, Bob is my guy. And, you know, I think he's not getting enough recognition. And in some ways, that's happening because he chose us. And he's the only player in our league to go to the combine and come back to college. He's the only player in the history of FAU to have stepped into an NBA combine. And it's kind of like he's just kind of floating under the radar. And this kid is a joy to coach. I mean, he's a 6'11 kid with point guard skills. He can dribble, pass, and shoot. His three-point shot is taking a leap. But he's an absolute sweetheart of a kid. And I don't want to see him miss things because he believed in us and chose us. Does that make sense? And, I mean, he had Kentucky, Wake Forest, Kansas State, and he ended up choosing FAU. And, man, are we proud of that. And I just hope that the people see what the NBA saw. The NBA thought he was good enough to invite him to combine. I think we see the same thing.
Ken and KyKy both had big seasons last year scoring the ball. What kind of impact do you anticipate that they'll have on the offense as a whole this season?
Yeah, I told the staff right off the bat, like, Macy Oteague and Adam Flagler changed our lives at Baylor. As two mid-major guards who averaged between 15 and 20, could shoot 40-3, were really good in their leagues, and then made the leap in their production didn't drop at all. And in some regards, both have gone up. And I think Kenny can do the same. I mean, 19 points a game, 18 points a game. KyKy's usage was way too high. He was carrying too much of a load. He shoots over 50% on contested three. So if you look at his three-point shot number, you're missing the larger point, is that when he plays with our guys and he gets easier shots, his shooting percentage goes through the roof. And then we scrimmaged yesterday with refs, and Ken had 10 rebounds and 5 assists. The 19 is special, but he's player of the year because he does a little bit of everything. And he's a really good player. They have two 23-year-old guards. And today's landscape, to step in and be almost ready-made, I would say that we're incredibly blessed that they told us yes.
One more question.
You coach plenty of skilled guards over at Baylor, guys like Davion Mitchell, Jacoby Walter, you know, NBA-type guys. How do you feel like you can apply those kind of coaching adjustments to the guards in this team?
Yeah, I think they translate well. I would say that one of the ways is Damon Parker, our head of player development. Damon was a GA at Baylor with Keontae George, Jeremy Sohan, Kobe Walter. And so then what I was doing early on with the GAs for Davion and Maceo, Adam, he kind of took and did with some of the guys that ended up lottery picks. And him and I actually went to the NBA lottery in New York City to see Jeremy get drafted. So Damon knows everything we do in a ball screen, everything we do on offense, and everything we do player development wise for a guard by heart. And so watching him get to be free here and do the things we really believe in, it has been great for me. And then I'll say most of player development is because the player buys in and they listen. and I think we recruit kids that are all in on learning what it means to be an athlete in college.
Do you see a little bit of Jeremy Sohan and Bobby Miller as kind of like a point forward by chance?
Some of that I think will end up ringing true. Right now I think we're trying a bunch of different things, but our lineup combinations, how we use plus minus, what positions different people will play, when we play small ball, when we play big, I think we're probably a couple weeks away from that, but he certainly has the skill set to do it.
It's been great so far. It's been great for all of us and the new coaching staff, and we're just ready to get to work.
Yeah, it's been great. You know, we got a lot of new guys, but we feel like we gel very quickly.
What's it been like first couple months at Boca since you've been here?
It's been different for me because I'm from Kentucky, so I'm not used to all the weather being so nice around here. So it's been a joy for sure.
Yeah, Boca is a nice place. I'm from Jackson, Mississippi, so it's a lot different from Boca. Yeah, it's kind of hot out here and it rains every day, so trying to get adjusted to that.
This your first hurricane?
Yes.
What do you think? A lot of drama, right?
A lot.
What have been the biggest challenges to being almost an entirely new team, everyone kind of getting to know each other, and you know, you have to go out there and be in a competitive conference coming off, you know, program coming off two NCAA tournaments. What's your experience been so far with that phenomenon?
It's been great. We've been taking it day by day. I feel like we've been just enjoying it. We've been trying to just get to the same place we've been for the last 2 years and trying to go better.
Yeah, it's very easy when everyone has the same goals, everyone is on the same page, it makes everything a lot easier.
Right here again, how's it been getting to know Montez and Montas both as basketball players on the court and then out as people off the court?
On the court, they're great basketball players. I didn't know Lithuanians can hoop like that. And off the court, they even better people, you know, probably some of the coolest dudes on the team. Sure.
Yeah, I love both of them on and off the court. They some great people on and off the court, and like I said, I'm just looking forward to playing with both of them. It's been a joy playing with both of them, getting to know both of them.
And just to expand on that real quick, both you guys being experienced guards in NCAA, what's it like playing with 2 7 footers? How's that guy gonna help you guys with your game?
Man, it's gonna be a tremendous help. Big body screens, you know, they hit the glass hard. They also have a lot of skill. That's one thing we didn't know about them when they first came here.
Cool, thank you.
And you were coached by Mo Williams, now Isaiah Austin is on the staff. That's a lot of basketball experience right there between those two guys. What is it like for you having impacts like that on your career?
You know, they both have ties with the NBA, so you know, that's what I'm trying to get to. So just getting, soaking up all the knowledge I can every time they talk.
What are some of your early impressions of Coach Jakus? Help us get to know him a little bit. What type of a head coach is he going to be? What type of a team is he going to be building? What's the culture going to be like?
He's a player's first coach. Like, he really cares about his players a lot. He wants everybody to be successful. Not only him, but everybody on the staff, including the players too. So it's been a joy, honestly. You know? And we love just being coached by him.
Yeah, I love Coach Jakus. Since I got here, well, since he started recruiting me, just made me feel like nothing but love and feel like I'm at home since I've been here.
And what's your experience been with the four returning players? Have they kind of been showing you what life is like at
B? Yes, they have. Jaquel, Dev, Jack, and Trey. They've been showing us what it's like here at FAU and what is expected. And they've been to the Final Four of March Madness, so they know what it takes and how everything should look.
Are they kind of teaching you guys the importance of those rivalries, like on their Final Four run, they played Memphis, and that'll be your home opener for AAC, but are they trying to get you into the correct mentality of teams like that?
We haven't really talked about teams individually, specifically, but we just know going into each game, we gotta be locked in as a team. And just go out there and perform well together.
The saying for this team is relationships over everything. What does that mean to you guys?
That means a lot to us. We treat our relationship very, very equally. We treat everybody the same. Doesn't matter if you don't play or play. We treat everybody the same.
What can you say about Bob Miller as a player on the court and a person who's going to be off the court?
Baba.
Go ahead. Yeah, I will. I just can't wait for y'all to see him. It's pretty crazy. He can shoot, he can pass, he dribble at his size. It's really crazy how he moves. He can come off the ball screen. Like, he can do a variety of lives, and it's very scary for him.
Yeah, we all know he's a great basketball player. I just want to talk about his character off the court. He's a great guy. You know, when I first got here, I think all the Americans were back home, so it was just the foreigners. And we grew closer together during that time, and we showed each other, like, we pushed each other during that week, and that's how we really got to know each other.
Have the NIL opportunities you guys have received at BU been a positive experience for you guys?
For me, it has, and for all of us. I mean, it's a new thing here, and it's been amazing.
Yeah, the NIL, it's been good. At my old school, we really didn't have NIL, so it's been a joy.
It would be understandable for you guys to have, you know, feel a little bit of pressure with all of the success this program has had in Final Four 2 years ago. How do you navigate that? How do you sort of maybe just temper expectations and pace yourselves a little bit?
I mean, it's not really pressure when you know you have goals and you know what's expected of you. So we just come in every day and go to work, try to get better, try to get 1% better each day, because we know we're going to have the fans on the outside here. They're going to sell out every game. They're going to be here. So we just get prepared to do our part.
What's your take on that?
Piggyback what he said, yeah. I mean, it's not really no pressure, for real. We know the expectation. We have to improve every night, you know. Just come every night, just working hard and just get it done.
What are you guys' thoughts? AAC has been a gritty conference, a lot of teams competing at the top. What are your guys' overall thoughts of the conference? Have you guys played against teams in the AAC before? And you guys goal to compete for that championship?
For sure, we definitely want to try to compete for championships every year. American is a great conference. I think we all know that when we're in. I think we're looking forward to it.
You know, with this being a new era with the transfer portal and you guys coming from your respective schools kind of being the guys in regards to scoring, what's kind of the chemistry like with the team in regards to who's going to handle the rock and kind of run the offense and kind of sharing the ball? What's the chemistry like right now, and do you feel like that's something that's going to have to develop as the season comes along?
I feel like we have great chemistry right now. You know, anyone on our team can have a great game, you know, can go out this game or however you want to play. So we just move the ball well, share the ball, and however it plays out, that's just how it goes.
Yeah, we got a lot of buck to give on the team, including this person right beside me. You know, you average score almost 80 a game. Like I said, I'm looking forward to fight with him and everybody else, but we have a lot of people that can do a variety of things, dribble the ball. Like a 1-4 can dribble the ball. We really don't have no point guard. Like, whoever gets the ball can just get it and go, and we just set the offense from there. So it's going to be, like, very, very hard to guard us, I feel like.
How do you think the offense has really been able to adapt to having bigs that are athletic and are able to shoot?
It makes our offense very versatile and hard to guard. When the 1-5 can shoot the 3, so.
I'm sure Trey has shared with you how crazy it could get out there on home games when, you know, you got a big crowd, loud. How much are you looking forward to just, you know, showing off your stuff in front of everyone on campus coming here and just joining the party?
I can't wait. I'm getting very excited, and I've seen a couple games and it get crazy in here, so I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, I definitely can't wait. I haven't played in a packed out gym with my fans and years, probably since like high school, so I'm ready for that.
For the amount of scoring that comes in between you guys, Leland, Baba, there's a lot of scoring to go around. You guys feel like you guys are just going to be able to maybe sacrifice some games to let somebody else step up?
For sure. Yeah, that's what makes a great team. We got a lot of people that can score the ball, and we don't have to rely on one person. We have multiple people that can put the ball in the hole, and that's going to make it easier for both of us, including the rest of the team, so we're looking forward to that.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.